Good morning, students. So let's start with the class.
Good morning.
Yeah, good morning. So here I'm making only either two of the CR says to make the centers. Okay. So you can start with I just wanted to start with the things related to your assignments. People who have sent the assignments through mail, that is those who face the issues that they are not able to send it through the Google Classroom alone, I'll be posting your marks in the Google Classroom itself. I have evaluated that. I'll send it back in your Google Classroom so that I can have a track that you have submitted the assignment and I'll not be missing out yours. Okay, so I'll return your marks in the Google Classroom. And regarding the assignment, for the people who I have given a less mark, I have mentioned the reason. So if you deserve again, you can verify it with me. It's not just simply just dropping a message asking for half a mark, one mark. See, whatever chart you are preparing, I cannot award 5 marks for all. If you have produced enough classification and categorization of the employees and organization structure, definitely you'll be awarded full marks there. Okay, it's like I have gotten more than 80 mails asking for marks. This is not fair, right? So you you should not expect all should get the same mark. Also, don't compare your marks with others. Each one of you, like except some 10 or 12 people, all have done their own works. So I should appreciate you for that. And related to the class timings, I'll post it in the CR's WhatsApp group. They'll be informing you when your class will be. I don't want any one of you sending me WhatsApp messages. So when I wake up in the morning, I get some 15 to 20 messages in the morning. If you want to contact me in person, or if you want to inform me something, kindly drop your message to any of your CRs. They'll put it in the group so that I will not miss their group messages. So if I am having 10 or 20, I'll be I also have my own routine, you know, like each and every time I do check, but I'll not be able to respond to all others. Frequently I'm telling, ma'am, you there, are you replying, are you seeing the messages, what is this type of messages I'm getting? So please provide my own space, whereas I hope I'm providing your space. I'm respecting all your messages, I'm replying to the maximum, I'm replying all, I'm not ignoring anyone. So if you have any doubts, or you wanted to tell something, you wanted to extend any deadline, or you wanted to get some marks, kindly post your roll number and your content to your CRs. Your CRs will post that message in the Google Classroom. If it is, in the WhatsApp group. If it is going to be in the WhatsApp group, then I'll be checking that group regularly. So I'll not be missing out your assignments or marks or any stuffs over there, okay? So if you send individual message, imagine you are 125 people, daily if I'm getting 20 messages from you, what will happen? I'll be missing out anything. So I just wanted to put only you can forward it to your CR. CR will be dropping it here. Or if you don't want to take it to that CR, you can post it in the Google Classroom. Maybe that, if I'm not checking that day, I'll be checking it on the next day. Okay. So wait, let me start with today's class. Can anyone of you start with the recap of the previous session? Yes.
Ma'am, we saw milestone charts, critical path method, and we saw both CPM and PERT.
CPM and PERT, okay. We started with our bar charts, improved charts, modified charts, and finally we came with our milestone charts. After milestone charts, we are in the basics of our CPM and PERT. So we have seen this slide, I hope so. So we have covered this slide. It is all related to the information that you are going to get in your CPM and PERT. So when you're drawing a network diagram, you will be able to identify. So if you have any doubts, you can take a screenshot of that slide and you can wait for the turn to end this class. Once your class is completed, you can ask. Or if you're really not able to cope up with that situation, you can stop me there. You can ask your doubt and let's discuss and move on further. So it is all related to your CPM and PERT networks. Whatever activities that you are going to carry out in your construction site, that you will be listing out in a sequential order. After listing out, you are going to draw it as a network diagram. Why are you drawing it as a network diagram? If you are writing all the contents. So if you are one technical head and I am one technical head, if you are doing it, next I have to look over it. I may not be understanding certain activities where you are carrying. Maybe I'll be asking after which activity you are carrying this activity. So there must not be some misunderstanding or misinterpretation in the activities. for that related to that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a network. The purpose of network is literally nothing but a concept of mind mapping. You're going to map everything, map all the activities with a particular durations. So once you are mapping up all it, you'll be able to analyze how many months or weeks are required to complete that particular activity. So I can track the progress of your construction or the phase of the construction in that activity. So you'll be having the lead time, the lag time, as well as if you are on schedule. You have estimated that laying of foundation takes about some 8 days or 9 days. So probably I am on the 9th day, I'm completing my task, which means I'm on time. I'm sticking on to my schedule. That also can be tracked in your network diagram. You can mention all those details. So it is not only for the understanding of your own individual who's creating, anyone in that field or the managers or the project managers or the construction managers, they'll be able to identify, okay, right now we are in the stage of concreting. In this concreting stage, we have completed 3 days or we're in the 4th day. So literally they'll be able to track your progress and they'll be able to know what is the entire length or the duration of the project. Similarly, if there is going to be any deviations, that also can be identified from your network diagrams. So next is our process of constructing a CPM or PERT charts. So how we are going to, it's simple. You are going to know what are the basic activities are going to be there. So after knowing the activities, you are going to place them in a sequential order. Probably from your A to Z, in your hierarchical order, you're going to place it. After which activity should start. So that you should know what is the preceding activity, that is the previous activity, also the succeeding activity, that is the next activity. So you should know the previous as well as the next activity and how these both are going to be interconnected. That also you should know. So analyze the project. So after analyzing the project, you should sit and study what the project is actually and what all the activity should be, it should comprise of. Define the project and all of its significant activities or the tasks. So that is nothing but listing out all the activities, that is defining the project. Next is sequencing the activities. So you know that you are going to have some 10 different activities in your project. Second point is you are going to sequence the 10 in the phase of your construction activities. So you are going to construct it. So next is develop the relationship among the activities. So after sequencing, as I told, you are going to connect it. Literally, you are going to provide a relationship for the previous and the succeeding, the preceding and the succeeding activities. And decide which activity must precede others. So when you are having the activity C, you should determine whether your activity A or your activity B will be the previous activity. So you should know all those should be interconnected. You should understand after which activity should come. Only then you will be able to know which will be the preceding activity. Draw the network connecting all of the activities. So I have some 10 activities here, or probably I'll take some, I'm having 5 activities. So I should connect all, only then I'll be able to end my project. If I am not, so I, in this case, I have 5 activities. If I'm not connecting my activity C or my activity D, this is my activity D. I am not connecting my A to D and D to E. If I'm not connecting, will I be able to come out with the proper critical path? Will I be able to come? So only if I connect all the activities, I'll be able to know which is coming after which and which is having the particular duration. And when I follow the 3 possible paths, from which path I'll be able to identify my critical path. So for this reason, we should connect all the activities that are taking place in our construction process. So you have to assign the time or cost estimates to each activity. If it is going to be our CPM method, that is a critical path method, by the term path, you can identify that you're going to end up in the calculation, the duration or the time that you're going to calculate for that, which is related to your time calculation, time estimation. So you can tell that when you're assigning the time, you will be using CPM. When you are going with the cost, you will be going for the PERT method. So this is what you will be using. Compute the longest time path through the network, that is known as the critical path. As we saw in the previous class, Now, for this network diagram, I have 5 activities here. That is A, B, C, D, E. So in this 5, I am I have 3 possible paths. What are my possible paths? One is going to be my A, B, and E. Okay. My next one is going to be my A, C, and E. Next is A, D, and E. So these are my possible paths. So this is my possible path 1. This is my possible. Let me take another pen. So this is my possible path 1. This is my possible path 2. And this is my possible path 3. So whenever you're into the project of calculating your time, you have the entire diagram. No matter whether it has 50 activities or 100 activities or 20 activities, irrespective of the number of activities, first sit and identify what are the possible paths. So, you know, when we are having these activities, you can tell that you have only three different paths. So, what happens? If I am having another one path here, which is connecting my B activity and C activity, so what will I do? I'll be getting 4 paths then. The additional path is going to be A, B, C, E. This is also my one of my path. So my additional path is going to be A, B, C, and E. So this is my next path. So when I consider this diagram as a whole, now I have 4 different paths. Do you agree with me? I have 4 different paths. So when you are having numerous activities, never miss out any possible path. So I can have this ABE as one of my path, ACE as my second path, ADE as my third path, and my fourth path is going to be ABCE. Okay, so you have 4 different paths. Now, having all the 4 different paths, yeah?
We can also have ACBE, right?
No. This is for this activity C. B is the preceding activity. You cannot, 1 minute. What happens is, you cannot take this path like this. You're asking this only, you know, A, C, B, E. You cannot go in this way because you should follow only your succeeding activities. When you are working in a network diagram, you should always follow your succeeding activity, not your preceding activity. So in that case, what I should do here is, I have to go by my A, B. After my B, I have 2 succeeding activities here. One is my E. Already I have that A, B, E. So my next activity is going to be C. From B, I can either go to E or I can either go to C. My arrow is in this direction, that is, my preceding activity is B and my succeeding activity is C. So I cannot go in the reverse. So I should follow only my succeeding activities. That's the reason we go for AB and B to C and C to E. Okay. Do you understand?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So our network diagram should always follow our succeeding activity because we are starting it from this. This is the start point. From the start point, we'll be going on till the end of the project. Our end is going to be E. So we are going to catch the next succeeding activity. That is nothing but the next steps that is going to take place. So we cannot consider any preceding activity here. So in this diagram, when you consider BC, your C is going to be your succeeding activity and B is the preceding or the previous activity. So we cannot go by this method. ACB is a wrong path. Only ABC is the right path. Okay. So you have 4 different paths here. Using these 4 different paths, you have time estimates like 7, 3. You have different values. As we saw in the previous example, now you'll be having different values for all the paths. You are going to list all the 4 paths. You are going to calculate the duration by following the 4 paths. And out of the 4, you will be having 1 maximum value. One path will give you the maximum value. That path is going to be your critical path. Is it okay? Are you all clear? Yes. Are you all clear? It's really very clumsy. Okay. Yes. Shall I move on to the next slide or you want me to repeat this again? Anyone reply?
And what if we have like two paths having the longest time then?
That we'll be seeing. That we'll be seeing in the next phases of our class. So now, as of now, I'm going to take you only the simple concepts. That problems also you'll be seeing.
Okay.
I'll tell you that when we are into that phase. Okay. But right now, I wanted all you to understand what is a network and what is the first step is going to calculate the critical path. So to calculate the critical path, what are the things you are going to do? That alone we'll be seeing in this class. So you have any other doubts? Any doubts? So we move to the next slide. Okay.
Ma'am. So,
yeah.
Ma'am, we'll be deciding these paths like ACE or ABE based on the information we have been given. Like it is said that the A is the initial activity and we have to reach the end E. In yeah. between B, C and D are occurring, which are taken up on different paths, right?
Yeah.
So we'll be having information about that. Then only we'll be able to know which one is the critical path.
Yes. All your details will be given, which means if you are having some 14 activities, all the duration of the 14 activities and after your 12th activity, your 13th activity will be starting, or your 12th and 13th activity will be meeting up at the 14th activity. So such informations will be given in your question. So it will be all known. The only thing you are going to calculate is the critical path.
And ma'am, based on those informations, we can have multiple paths. Within yeah. that network.
Yeah, you'll be having multiple paths. Probably okay. When it is a case of five notes or five activities, for that itself you are having four different paths. Probably in the same diagram, I may connect it to another activity. I may be having some intermediate activity that is connecting my C to D. So in that case, I'll be having another one possible path extra. So depending upon the question and depending upon the activities and the duration, you'll be having multiple possible paths.
Okay.
Yeah. Once you started drawing the diagram, like you have to make sure whether you have drawn the diagram in the particular way that you are matching it with the precedence relationship. I hope you understand with the precedence relationship. That is nothing but the previous relationship. When you are connecting with it, you should make sure like all the activities have been mentioned in the diagram. After drawing the diagram, then you have to sit and list what are the possible paths. That starts with your A and ends with your E activity. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So now is project network. So for framing this project networks, that is your network diagrams, we have two different methods to calculate. First one is going to be activity on arrow. You call it as AOA. The second method is going to be activity on node, that is AON. So you call it as AOA, AON. So here and after we are going to call it as AOA and AON. So what is AOA? Arrows represents the activities and nodes are events for points in time. So this is going to be my activity. I mark my designation or the name of my activity upon the arrow. Do you understand? Activity on arrow is nothing but you draw an arrow, you put the name of the particular activity. This is activity on arrow. Next is activity on node. It's nothing but you have one node here and it is connected with the next node here. So it will be like this. So this is my A node and this is my B node. And this is going to be my activity. So sorry, one second. So this is going to be my activity 1 and activity 2, or you can call it as activity A and activity B. So your activity will be placed upon the node sections. That is called activity on node. When you're putting the activity on the arrow mark, then you call it as activity on arrow mark. Is it all clear? So based upon this only, your diagrams will be classified here and after. So if you're going to put the activity upon your arrow, you call it as AOA, activity on arrow. If it is going to be activity on node, you name your activity near the node. That is, this node is called the activity A and this node is called the activity B. Simultaneously, if you have any other placing of concrete or formwork, removing the formwork or placing the formwork, so that particular node is going to be designated as removal of formwork, placing of formwork or laying of concrete. Okay. So we'll see an example related to this. So if it is going to be AOA, that is activity on arrow, which means I have nodes here. This is my activity. It starts from the first point to second point. This is my activity. Design house and obtain financing. So this is my first point. This is my first activity. I'm just naming the nodes as 1 and 2. Don't get confused. I'm just naming my nodes as 1 and 2, whereas my activity is placed near my arrow mark. You can either give it at the top or you can either give it at the down or on the side. That doesn't matter. Okay. So one side you should have your that is time duration, and other side you should have your name, that is the name of the activity. So my first activity is going to be design house and obtain finance. Second activity is you lay foundation, order and receive materials. You have a dummy here. Select paint, build a house, select carpet, finish work. So I have my activity, node starting from 1 till 7. So can you tell me what are the possible paths for this activity? For this network diagram, possible paths. I'll write it here with different color pen. So this diagram. So just see from node 1 to node 2. I can take it as 1 to 2 to 3, and from 3 to 4, and from 4 to 5, as well as from 5 to 6 and 6 to 7. This is my one possible path. Okay, which means 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This is one possible path. Okay. Next possible path, it is going to be in red color. Okay. So I am going to mark it as 1, 2, 3, 4, 6. I don't go to 5. I am directly going to 6. 6, 7. Because this 6... For the sixth activity, you can either go by this way or you can directly go, because this sixth, it has two meeting points. That is the end of the fourth as well as end of the fifth activity. You understand? My fourth activity and my fifth activity are ending and meeting up in sixth activity. So I can consider this as my next possible path. That is 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7. Okay, this is my second. Oh, so what will be my third possible path? I want any one of you to tell me what will be my third possible path. The slide is very dark. Okay. So any one of you tell me the third possible path.
Ma'am, what are these numbers mentioned over the arrow represent?
These numbers.
Yes, ma'am. Three.
It's nothing but the time duration.
Okay, ma'am. Okay. And ma'am, the path you gave in the second one, 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7. In that, you are bypassing fifth one.
Yeah.
Ma'am, it means we are not selecting paint and carpet.
No. It's not that way. What I am coming to tell is that when you are going to start your sixth activity, it is given that your fourth activity and fifth activity are going to end up in sixth activity. So for my sixth activity, I do have two precedents. That is, I am ending up in the fourth and fifth. So I can take either this 4, 6 and 7 path, or I can go to my 4, 5, 6, 7. So why it doesn't mean
going through the path means after completing that activity, we are like if you are selecting the paint, we are going from 4 to 5.
Okay.
If you're going from 5 to 6,
I agree with you. After the selection of paint, selection of carpet, we go to this. But what we are going to calculate is, we are not going to calculate the hierarchical steps here. We are going to calculate the duration only. Imagine here, the duration is 1 plus 1. You have only 2 days here. Okay. Whereas when you go from 4 to 6 directly, you have 3 days there. So you have one day in addition. Okay. Which you
we are getting to know about different paths to calculate only the time required, the maximum time required for finishing.
Yes, we are going to calculate only the time. Make sure we should give only the maximum scheduled time. So I am buying a house from you. You are a designer. You are telling that you will hand over the key within 120 days. Okay. But if you take all the possible paths, if you calculate the critical path, you are getting it as 130 days. You are just telling it as 120 days. If you take it as 130, if you are able to give it by 120, I am okay. But if you are not able to give at 120, will I come and fight with you or not? Will all my 10 days of finance, my stores, my resources goes waste, right?
Yes, ma'am.
That's the reason. We have to identify the maximum possible path. Maximum, you can go for the maximum. Yeah. You can calculate the maximum possible path. And if you're finishing your project within prior time or before the previous deadline, it is well and good. But we always provide the maximum time there. Okay. Any other doubts?
No.
So 1 minute, let me wrap this and let me go to the next possible path. So can anyone of you tell me what is the next possible path? One, two, four, six, seven, which means 1, 2, 4, 6, 7. Okay. So is there any other path or that's all?
And 1, 2, 4, 5, 6.
Wait, let me take another color. I have only very small colors. Okay. So tell me the another path. It is 1, 2, 4, 5, 7. Yeah. 5, 6, and 7.
That's
okay. So this is my another path. It is 1, 2, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Now you have to calculate the values for each and every activity. That is, you're going to calculate the time duration. So when I'm taking my first path, that is the brown color path, if I'm taking 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So my 1 is nothing but 3. That is first activity is 3 plus, what is my next activity? 2. I'm going to 2 to 3. For my 2 to 3, my activity duration is 2. Again, for my activity 3 to 4, it is 3 to 4, it is 0. So I put 0 plus when I'm going from my 4th to 5th, I have 1 day there. Plus when I'm moving from 5th to 6th, I have 1 more day. From my 6th to 7th, I have 1 more day. So what does it get tallied to? 3, 6, 8. Yes. This first path goes for 8. Similarly, you have to calculate for other possible paths. That is your red color, yellow color, and your black color paths. So when you calculate all the 4 different things, you can, if you want, you can just take a screenshot of this slide and you can sit and try whether what are the possible paths, and you can analyze which is the critical path. For that case, okay, you can take a screenshot of this slide, and also I'll rub all this things which I have written, and it will be more clear. You can work on yourself. Have you taken a screenshot of this particular slide? Anyways, I'll be posting all your PPTs. So if you want to try it today, you can take a screenshot. It's not mandatory that you should take it now. So let me rub all those steps. So if you want, you can take another screenshot of this also. So we told that we have 4 different possible paths here. Out of 4, which gives you the maximum? That is going to be your critical path. Any doubts? Okay. So the next thing is, now we are going to see the same thing using our AON, activity on node. For my activity on node, I place my activity on the nodal area. This is my nodal area. I position my activities here next to my nodes. So for this, always I have a start. You just draw a box, mention it as start. From the start, this is going to be my first activity. So it is nothing but design house and obtain financing. So I'm putting as design house and obtain financing. This red color indicates that it is nothing but your sequential order. That is, you can see here, it is 1, 2, it is nothing but the nodal representation. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, that is your nodal representation. It is not mandatory that you should follow the same color. You can give it as either blue, black or something. If you go for nodal diagram, either you can just give it as one and close it, or you can just put a box, a line in between, and you can separate it, telling that one is going to be your activity, activity number, and the second is going to be your number of time duration. For my design house and obtain financing, the time duration is 3 days. It is 3 days also here. Similarly, when I go for laying of foundations, my activity number is 2, as well as my time estimate is 2. Activity is 2 and time estimate is also 2 here. This is how, it is to the similar concept, you're going to plot this. Next is going to be, so what are the situations you face in your network diagram? I hope you might have understood what is a network diagram. So I'll tell you how you are in a position to place all those arrows or nodes in the sequence. So what are the basic situations in the network diagram? So when I have three activities here, mentioning that A, B, C. So A must finish before either B or C can start, which means after my A is getting completed, I can either go with B or C, which means there are two different works that could be started. After my completion of A, which means when you're putting an arrow like this and when you're mentioning a node like this, imagine it like this, which means this previous activity is completed. Only then I'm going for the next activity. In some cases, I'll be having only one possible path. That is, I will be having only B. In some situations, I'll be having C also, which means both for A, you have two successive activities, B and C. When you compare B, you have one preceding activity. When you compare C, you have one preceding activity. Can you understand? I'm really sorry for scribbling this. I can't do anything. Okay. So the next thing is going to be both A and B must finish before C can start. I do repeat this again. Both A and B, your A and your B must finish. I told you that when an arrow is meeting up with a node, which means that activity is getting finished. So my A and B are getting finished before I begin with my activity C. Are you all clear with this point? Yes. If you tell me yes, I will proceed to the third point.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so the next case, both, you may think, ma'am, this is very simple. If you read itself, you are able to understand. You may understand now, but when you're dealing with complex networks, you may have a mild confusion, ma'am, what is this? I'm getting confused with this arrow, with this network, with this diagram. It's not all working out for me. You should not get any confusions. That's why I'm going step by step. So the next point is going to be both A and C must finish before either B or D can start, which means my A and B are ending up in the same point. This both, either of this A or B should end, only then either of my C or D will be starting up. You will be having such activities when you go for complex structures. So A, B should end up before the starting of C or D. It may be either C or it may be either D. I can tell that my A activity can have C and D as my succeeding activities. Also my B activity, I'll take another color. If I go for B, my B activity may have C and D as two succeeding activities. So when I'm going to my calculation of my precedence activity, I'll be able to tell that for my C, I'll be having either A or B as my precedence relationship. So when I'm going C, when I'm considering C, I'll be neglecting this D. I'll be directly going to the previous activities. So I may have either A or B. So what you have to do is for the activity C, the precedence relationship is A comma B. You may either have A or B. So when I'm going for the calculation of D's precedence relationship, so D is my activity now. So let me erase off this. Now D is my activity. For my D activity, what all the things should I consider now? What is my precedence activity? For my activity D, my activity is D is here. It is starting here. When, how does it start? Only if either my A or B ends, only will be starting. So I have the precedence relationship as A comma B. I have two different activities here. So this is the third point. Are you clear with this point? One minute. Okay. Are you all clear with this? Okay. Now I'm going to my fourth point. That's nothing but activity A. Activity B is here, C is here, D is here. A dummy is provided in between. Once again. Okay. So in this situation, A must finish before B. Yeah, A is finishing, only then B is getting started. Both A and C must finish before D can start. What they are trying to tell is both the activity C, I mean A and C, this both should get completed before the start of D activity. I already have a diagram here where I am connected to A and B. I have another diagram, C, that is getting connected to D. Okay, are you all understanding this point, this diagram which I am drawing? Are you understanding this, what I have drawn here? So which means my B should start after the completion of A, my D should start after the completion of C. So this is two different arrow diagrams. Now what I want is, I wanted my, read this point again, both A and C must finish before I can start with my D, which means I want my A to get connected to this completion point. Only then I'll be starting my D point. This is an separate activity. This is a separate sequence. Also, this is a separate sequence. I have a twist in between. They are requesting me, or they are suggesting me to carry over my A activity to this completion node. Only then I'll be starting the D. For that case, what I'm doing is I am providing a dummy here. Okay, I'm providing a dummy where I cannot just drag and push this here. Are you all clear with this, what I told? I am providing a dummy. I'll tell you why I am providing you a dummy. If I'm not providing a dummy here, what will happen? If I'm not providing a dummy there, how will I be able to connect all those things? How will I be able to connect my A with my C? Can I draw a diagram like this? It is having, see, this is your A. What you want, you just want B to start from A, that is starting. And this is my C. And this is my D. So do you agree with the first point now? I just wanted to make sure whether all are you along with me. Listen here, I don't want to miss this concept, because when you are moving on for numerous activities, when you are drawing the diagram, you will be getting dummies. They were most of the people or your seniors made so much mistakes in the end semester and missing out their dummies. I don't want anyone to miss this concept. See, kindly put your ears here and listen. See, what's my first point? If I am drawing a diagram like this, here I haven't introduced any dummy. All are my real activities. In that situation, I read my first point. A must finish before B can start. Is it the same? A is getting finished here. B is getting started. Do I have any other extra precedence for my B?
Yes, ma'am. C.
C. Yeah. So in that case, I cannot provide like this. My A cannot come and directly hit my C. But what they require, is this yellow color visible? So what they actually require is they want my A and C to meet. This is my requirement. What's my requirement is A and C to meet together, and only then my D will be starting. Okay. So only my A and C should meet together. Only then my B will be starting. This is what they require. Both A and C must finish. This both should finish. Only then my A will be starting. So my actual requirement is this. My actual requirement is this. But I cannot provide in this way. Because I also I'll be having another activity. That is my B activity. Where I am forced to provide that B activity. In that case, I cannot redraw this diagram like this. I cannot redraw this diagram like this. Do you understand? Just like that, I cannot connect my A and C. Though if it is going to be workout for my activity D, the requirement for my D is going to be A and C. That I have met up with. But the requirement for the B, that is the precedence relationship of my B, it should carry only my B activity, should carry only my A activity and not the C. That's the reason I am taking it into two separate diagrams. So that's the reason I am taking into two separate activities. So this is my A and this is my B. My first problem is met out. That is, A is finishing, B is starting. And my second thing is A and C must finish before D can start. So this is my D and this is my C. So I am satisfying the C alone. C is finishing, only then my D is starting. Now I am forced to provide a dummy where I can connect my A with my C to meet with the, or to start with this activity D. So I am connecting my A to C with a dummy. If you are drawing a network diagram with a dashed line, that is called a dummy. Okay. If it is going to be a solid line, then nothing but a representation of your network diagram. If it is going to be a dashed line, always remember dashed line represents the dummy. Okay. I have so many artists in the class where what they do is, they provide your entire network diagram with a dashed line and they give only the critical path with their solid line, which means your entire diagram goes wrong. Do you understand? Always your dummy should be marked with the dashed line and not with the solid line. Okay, so this is why I am providing dummy here. Hope you understood the concept of providing the dummy. Yes. If you have any doubt, you can tell, or we'll be moving to the next topic. Shall we move to the next topic? Okay, so let me move. I hope you don't have any doubts. Okay, next is, yeah, you have any doubt?
I'm in the before slide.
Yeah.
Before.
This previous slide.
Ah, yes, that screenshot. In that, we can't go with 1, 2, 4, no, 1, 2, 4.
1, 2, 4. Like, why can't you go for 1, 2, 4?
2, 3 should be completed.
No, you're going to identify only the possible path. I just wanted to register a point here. If you're directly going from 1, 2, 4, skipping out 3, doesn't mean that you are not going to bring that activity into practice. See, you're going to have all the activities into practice. Only we are going to identify what are the possible paths you can consider and you can end up with the maximum value. Your target is to identify the maximum duration. That is the reason we are going in all the possible directions to identify the maximum duration value. Okay. I can go from 1, 2, 4, 5, 6, 7. That is my first, one path also. I can skip 3 here. Okay.
Okay.
Are you clear? Still, you have any doubt?
No, ma'am.
Okay. You can ask, ma'am, for this sixth activity, I am having two different endpoints. So, which means how, like you can ask, I should not skip this point. No. For the sixth activity, that is the sixth node, you have two different precedence relationship. So I can either have this two, that is, I can either have my fourth activity connecting to my sixth, or I can either have my fifth activity connecting to my sixth. I can consider this path 1, 2, 4, 6, and 7, or I can either go by 1, 2, 4, 5, and 6. For the sixth activity, I can go in two different paths. So similarly, as what one who asked, now I don't remember your name. Okay. So for that, when you are asking, I understood your question that you are having the fourth activity here. For this, you have two different paths. That is, it is preceding activities 2 and preceding activities 3. This situation, I have two possible paths here. Always understand, when you are having a node ending up with two activities, I am having a node 4. Where I am ending up with two activities, that is my second and my third activity is ending here. Only then I am able to proceed with my fourth activity. If I am having two precedents, which means I am having two possible paths here. If I am considering my activity 1 to 4, this is only my project. Okay, you leave off all those things. You leave off the entire thing. My project is only from 1 to 4. This time tell me what is the possible paths here. I can go from 1, 2, again, from 2 to 3 I can go, and 3 to 4 I can go. And what is the next path here? 1 to 2, 2 to 4. I don't have a possible path directly to jump from 1 to 4. I have only two paths. So I'm considering only the two possible ways, which means here your fourth activity is having two precedence relationship, that is 3 and 2. So I am including the third activity here, including the second activity, which means I'm getting two possible paths. You can either call it as PP. PP is nothing but the possible paths. You can have two possible paths here. Okay. This is okay. So we saw up to our fourth activity in this slide. We have covered up to fourth activity. So for this, you have two possible paths. So when you are taking the sixth activity, as I told, when an activity is ending up with two different activities, that is 4 and 5, what I do? I'll be having two more possible paths. Is that true? My activity 6 is ending up with another two precedence relationship. So I have another two possible paths. That is why when we calculated the entire list of possible paths, we had a total of 4 possible paths. Here 2 and here 2. I can either go by this way or I can either go by this way. Similarly, in this case, I can either go by this way or I can go by this way. So here 2 plus here 2, total summation of 4 possible paths here. Is it okay? Is it okay to all? If you have any doubts, let me explain it again. Are you clear? Shall we move on to the next slide?
Yes,
okay. So let me stop it here.